Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to this Green Growth Dialogue second workshop. The title of the workshop is called Green Transformation Through Experimental Governance. And I thought that this title would capture the many different aspects of the different themes that we're going to be talking about these 2 days, some of us 3 days. And also the format of this workshop, which is very much in itself an example of experimental governance. So let me just begin by explaining that there are really 4 purposes of this workshop. And it's a second workshop, so it's a series of workshops. We've planned, we had the first workshop in Tórshavn, the Faroe Islands, in late April, where we also launched the new master's program in West Nordic Studies, Governance and Sustainable Management, which this research network is really part of or springs from. It's what I call an extended research community, and extended research community can mean several things, but what I really want to emphasize is that it's not just researchers getting together in a community, it's bringing in students, it's bringing in many other types of knowledges and actors. And I'll get back to that later. So the first purpose is, of course, to further strengthen this new extended research community by meeting. Because one of the things of knowledge in a community is that, we can create knowledge, but if we don't meet and if we don't actually perform and practice that knowledge, then it doesn't really matter a lot. So many examples of knowledge just getting stuck in a database somewhere. The production of the knowledge was then the important process, but using that knowledge afterwards tends to get forgotten. So you have to meet and actually do the knowledge. And then, as I said, it's also about bringing in the students from the West Nordic master's program. And can I just ask the students to raise their hands so we can see how many are actually in this program? And there are some other people here who are also students but not with the program, or just very interested in this. So I'm really excited about having the students here and contributing with your knowledge and expertise, but also to contribute with your ideas for the future, because that's really where we want to go. Then a third purpose of the workshop is to explore small states and small communities, what they can do, what role they can play in the transformation to a green economy. And that means both at global scale or more local or regional scale. And it ties well into why we are here in Reykjavik, working with the University of Iceland and the Small States Center. This is one of their expertise, and I think world-leading center. And we'll hear much more about that later. And of course also why we have the Ministry of Foreign Affairs from Denmark here to talk about not just diplomacy and the global scale of things, but how to really connect the local and global scales. And last but not least, it's also about reflecting on this type of dialogic practice as a new form of governance. And that might sound a bit academic, and that's because it is. It's part of my own research interest to really explore what it means to meet with people outside of university and engage in dialogue and create new knowledge and explore new ways of doing things, because we sit many times in university with a lot of knowledge, but it just doesn't transform into the right practices. So it's important also to reflect on what it is that we're actually doing here these 2 or 3 days, and what we're going to do in this community over a longer period of time. And hopefully we'll be able to write a research paper at some point, maybe together with students, maybe together with other actors as well. I think that would be great. Okay, just to set the scene, why it's so important that we're doing this, and why I think that we really need to explore this way of getting together and speaking about the future. So we have a climate crisis that's not new to anyone, and we've had more than 20 years of international negotiations on this, but the climate crisis is really only getting worse. So the question is, do we really need more science? Do we need more knowledge? I mean, it seems that we've just been building up knowledge for the past 20 years or more, and it's not really getting translated, or we're not seeing anything significantly change. Do we need more politics? Well, many of you know about the coming Paris meeting, the COP21, UN climate negotiations later this year in December. And all expectations are really that it's not going to deliver the goal of a 2 degree or even less world. So do we need more politics? Do we need more governance? Well, maybe we do, but not in the form it takes right now. Maybe it's time for a change. But we'll discuss that during these days. Another crisis, the financial crisis, is also a backdrop of all of this, or an economic crisis. And that's a global crisis, and Iceland surely also knows of a local economic financial crisis. Many other countries have the same. And this really should make us reflect on if business as usual is the right way forward, if growth, as we've seen before, is the right way to deal with not just the climate, but also our financial institutions and so on. And then there seems to be a knowledge crisis, as I alluded to before. So we have a knowledge transfer problem, or at least we think we do. Knowledge is not transferred from where knowledge is produced in universities or think tanks to practice. But maybe that's the wrong analysis. Maybe it's not a knowledge transfer problem, maybe it's a knowledge production problem. Because if we don't take ownership of knowledge, it's really difficult to use it and apply it. And how do we take ownership of knowledge? Well, if we're part of producing the knowledge, then we usually take ownership of that knowledge. And how do we then do that? Well, we have to get together and produce knowledge together. So instead of just everyone doing their own thing and expecting others to then think that's a good idea, it doesn't seem to work. But we also have a different, there's also a different situation of this knowledge crisis, and we're experiencing that in universities around the world, many other public organizations are experiencing the same thing, lack of funding. Everyone needs to cut back or be more efficient, as I think it's called. And is that because there's a lack of trust in what we do in universities? Could be. And if we don't show what we are worth, if we don't show the value of universities and what we do, probably gonna be a lot worse than it is now. And maybe Leslie can speak to us much more about the situation in Canada in the breaks. Okay, so we have Part of this green growth dialogue is also a Canadian West Nordic research network. And I'm very pleased that Leslie King from Royal Roads University, British Columbia, is here with us. Leslie, as you may know, has been working on these issues, environmental and climate issues, and the Arctic, for at least more than 10 years.
Thanks, Rob.
And Leslie has also been part of setting up the University of the Arctic and really been a driving force in getting these regions and people together. So she has a lot of insight that we're going to tap into and really do what we can to use that and you know, strengthen these ties and these networks and practices. The West Nordic Master's Program is a program with five universities, University of Greenland, Iceland, Akureyri, Norland, Bodø in Norway, and University of the Faroe Islands. And we've only just started, really. We had the first introductory course in Akureyri last week. It ended yesterday. So students here have already spent 11 days working very hard. But it also means that everyone is up to scale and are really ready to start working on these things. We ended the discussion yesterday at Akureyri on a very negative or pessimistic note with the crisis. You know, it's so this is the state of the situation. It's very severe. And what are we going to do? So, but hopefully this will be part of the answer. And then we have so far four Canadian universities who have joined us. From McGill, Peter Brown and Nicolas Corsoy, working on ecological economics. And it's really been a driving force in local and global development of a new thinking about economic growth and sustainable development. Unfortunately, they weren't able to come this time around, but from one of the research groups there, we have two people presenting tomorrow online, and we'll have a discussion with them tomorrow. From Toronto, Stephen Bernstein and Matthew Hoffman, working on issues of scale and transformation. Unfortunately, due to family matters and other problems, they weren't able to join us either this time around, but hopefully next workshop they'll be able to join us. And Matthew Patterson from Ottawa is also part, and of course Leslie King, as I mentioned, she's here. And I should say that the network is supported by NORA, the North Atlantic Corporation. And they have been very instrumental in also bringing about the ideas of even setting up this cooperation between the universities and the new master's program. But we are looking for other funds, we are looking for other platforms or other ways of anchoring this research community. So we are still building it or exploring ways it can end up. So if you have any ideas, you know, we'll talk about that in many of the breaks. Okay, let me just go back to something about the reasons why we're here and why we need this other approach. Andrew van der Ven is writing a lot about what he calls engaged scholarship and the engaged scholarship model. And the diagnosis is really that the history of science and technology demonstrates that many extraordinary advancements have often been initiated by problems and questions posed from outside the scientific enterprise. Scholarship that engages both researchers and practitioners can provide an exceedingly productive and challenging environment. It not only fosters the creation of knowledge for science and practice, but it may dissolve the theory-practice gap. And he comes from a background in health sciences, and has been working with hospitals and doctors and nurses and so on, and that it really makes sense. That's a perfect place of experimenting and working together with practitioners, whereas we are not so used to that in the social sciences and humanities, I would say, and especially working with politics and businesses. It's as if there is this huge barrier of mistrust, or that it's really two different worlds, and I mean, I come from a background in political science, and even there's a big gap or mistrust between all these different worlds. So hopefully we can break down some of these barriers and share our thoughts and experiences. So the dialogue part of this is really to create a common starting point by getting together and by talking together. So we agree on not just what the problems are, but and maybe not agree on everything, but so we share our different experiences of how we see the problems, because a problem in itself is never objective or neutral. There are many different perspectives about what a problem is. I mean, climate change means something different to everyone in this room, depending on where you live, your life experiences, and so on. The same with the financial crisis or a knowledge crisis or whatever other crisis you might find more relevant even. There are many problems or crises to pick and choose from. So it's about listening to other perspectives about the challenges and visions in relation to these crises and problems. Where do we want to go with this? What sort of future do we envisage? What sort of world do we want to live in? And by sharing these thoughts and perspectives, we can learn a lot from each other, and we can maybe make some other choices in our own daily work. And it's about formulating new questions together. Because if I stay back in my office at university and I read a lot of the books and papers that come out from other researchers, I might not ask the right questions. And I know that from my experience with my PhD project, where I studied global governance of climate change, I started reading a lot. And then I went to the United Nations climate negotiations, and I saw a totally different world than what I was actually reading about. And all the nice questions I had formulated and the big nice research project I had set up made no sense whatsoever when I met the world, and I saw that actually there's a lot of positive things going on as well. And there is a very interesting community in the United Nations climate negotiations. Because people are meeting there year after year, even throughout the year. They really have a strong community, and they meet and talk across these boundaries. We think that civil society is there, and the NGOs are there, and all they do is shout and say that everything is wrong, nothing is happening. But that's the media representation of what we see. What goes on behind the scenes is actually that, you know, NGOs and experts, scholars are invited in to negotiations to contribute and have dialogue with policymakers and so on. But it's not reflected in our theories of governance. And I think that's really interesting, that we have a world out there that is very different from the theories about the world we have and we spend so much time on in university. And so so that's why it's important to formulate new questions together, so we can change our theoretical models of the world and what actually needs to be done and what is going on. And the more I get to learn about the Arctic and Arctic governance, I can see the same thing. You know, there's already lots of interesting networks and different types of people and actors who are working together. And maybe we can tap more into that as well during this this workshop. So co-producing new knowledge is also about maybe creating new language or new words for some of the things that we experience. Because if I use the same academic language as I'm taught, maybe you won't understand me. If other actors use the same, let's call it a new management language, maybe I won't understand you, or maybe civil society won't understand that as well. So let's try to explore new words or new sentences or new ways of approaching these things. And then I think we have to redefine the meaning of growth and development. And this means, I mean, many in this room, of course, already part of this already, and you know what I'm talking about. And it's been an ongoing discussion since the late 60s, at least. But what is so important about this, I think, is that what we're experiencing worldwide is a struggle to define the meaning of growth and development at the moment, and it's we see many old universities, Oxford and in the States and Canada and in France and around the world, where they're setting up new research groups together with other people to redefine the new economics. And there's still a lot of opposition against this from especially the old neoclassical economic fortresses around the world and in ministries of finance and so on. But there is a big change. There is a big discussion going on right now, and I think we are part of that debate, and I think we should be very conscious about this, and I think we should take it seriously, and I think we should be try to be very precise when we say, what do we mean by growth? What do we mean by development? What is a more qualitative and what is a more inclusive understanding of growth and development in a sustainable perspective in a against the backdrop of climate crisis and financial crisis and knowledge crisis and maybe a crisis of trust? So these are big questions and big tasks. And it's also about co-producing new practices of getting there, as I said before. And what I really hope we can do with this workshop is that, I mean, we won't find all the answers, and it's not about telling each other afterwards that, so you have to do this or you have to do that. It's hopefully about creating an atmosphere of inspiration where each and every one of us can take something back from here and use that in our own daily work afterwards. And hopefully we'll also get to know each other a bit more, so we'll keep in touch and meet again for other workshops or meet online or anything is really possible here. Okay, so for more practical introduction, I'll just say something about today and tomorrow and this workshop. So today, this morning, we are going to focus on theme one, as it's called in the program, small states, green diplomacy and green nation branding. And our first speaker will be from this university, Pia, sitting right there and ready to talk and ready for questions and further dialogue afterwards. And we have Lisbeth Jespersen from 3GF, the Global Green Growth Forum, and she'll be speaking much more about that. Unfortunately, Stefan Gislason has fallen ill and will not be able to join us today. So we'll have a bit more time for questions and dialogue. And if anyone in this room knows anything about Iceland's strategy of moving into a green economy, want to share a few things afterwards, the floor is open. Then we'll after these presentations, we'll break into smaller groups. We'll be able to set up some tables and chairs in the back there. You're welcome to make a small group here, stay here, or go to the big hall and walk around and talk. You're welcome really to join any group you want, small or big group. I think at least three groups with the amount of people we are now. And I'll try to circulate and listen to what you're talking about and help get discussion going if you need help with that, but I don't think you do. But some of the questions I really want to address, or I think we should address, are why should small countries even take part in global climate action? And I hear this a lot from Faroe Islands or smaller communities, people saying, we're so small, our impact means nothing in the global scale of things. So why should we even do something? It's too expensive for us to do anything. Well, if everyone thought that way, nothing would happen. So we really need to address these issues. And of course, one of the answers to this question has been given by many already, is that, there are also many opportunities in doing something even though you're small, because you might be able to develop a new model of doing things that can be a new export good. People might want to copy you. What difference can small Nordic countries play globally? And then the question of, is there a Nordic small state approach to green growth? Green growth has been on the agenda in Nordic countries for many years, since at least 2009. And the Nordic Council of Ministers are working a lot with green growth. But it's also different from country to country. Some countries, in Denmark, it's very much anchored in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. There's a global approach there, whereas in other countries it's focused more on local and regional development within business and so on. So there could be many differences that I think we should also explore here. And maybe we can talk about what are the strengths and weaknesses of this Nordic way or a Nordic approach to science, policy, relationships, and so on. And how might we strengthen the ties between science, policy, business, and society? One of the major problems I've also noticed doing research on green growth is that it's really difficult to get civil society engaged in this agenda. And it could be because of the word growth. There seems to be a very big opposition in academia and in civil society against the word growth. And that's because it's the old understanding of growth. The dominant understanding of we just need more growth, we just need a bigger GDP, and in that understanding, the environment and climate is not really factored in. So when someone comes along and says we can do it in a green growth way or sustainable growth or any other term, people start to become suspicious and think that it's, you know, it's just another example of greenwashing, or it's just rhetoric and nothing is really changing. Well, if you don't participate, then surely nothing will change. But how can we then strengthen the ties between science, policy, business, and society? And how can we maybe get civil society to participate a lot more? Okay, so then this afternoon, we're going to talk about scaling up green experiments, small innovations, and societal capacity building. And these questions are, and theme is particularly relevant for Faroe Islands, Iceland, and Greenland. And I really hope that all of you from these countries will participate in this dialogue. And we have presentations by Alexander from Iceland, and Laura from the university here, and myself. And we'll also move into smaller groups and start out with these questions. So what are the barriers and promises of scaling up experiments? Is there such a thing as experimental governance? What does it look like? And how can local experiments be part of a global transformation to a green economy? And what can different actors do to support experimental governance? But we'll get back to Monday afternoon after lunch. I'm sure you're already thinking about, let's just get started. So Tuesday's program, I'll just briefly go through. So we'll talk about the transformation to the green economy in, we'll set up groups immediately, and you're free to start out with one of these groups and change groups if you want to. So we'll have one group talking about global public-private partnerships as an approach, green diplomacy. Then we'll have a group focusing specifically on Greenland, and one specifically on Iceland, and one specifically on the Faroe Islands. And then Tuesday afternoon, we have a presentation by the research group at McGill University. And it's an attempt to share with you a research proposal and to get feedback to see, does it make sense to anyone outside of academia what we're working with. So it might be a bit theoretical, but hopefully we'll be able to tie it up with practical problems and challenges. So it's the approach is called nested institutions, and we'll explain that further tomorrow afternoon. So before we get started, I just want to share with you some of the insights that we had from the first workshop in Tórshavn in April, because this some of these insights really is the starting point from for where we are today in this workshop. Now, first of all, it was a great workshop, well received by many different actors, and many different participants came. We are still working on setting up the homepage, where you'll be able to watch the presentations there and read some of the material that was created. But the lessons learned really was that the global transformation is happening right now in our thinking and in practice, and we should be there, be part of this. And then there was a question of going beyond hobby. We heard some very good examples of people, entrepreneurs, who had developed a small thing where they could save energy, or they could reduce oil spills in ships, or they, I mean, small projects that people really started out of a personal interest and really started out as a hobby, and people spend a lot of money, their own money and time on this. But how do we get these small hobby projects beyond hobby, you know, from small to big is very difficult. And so that's one of the things that we are going to explore more at this workshop. Then we also learned from the energy company in the Faroe Islands that small societies are also excellent sites for experimental governance, meaning that it's so small scale that in a global perspective, when a big a producer of a battery, for example, big battery station for harnessing wind energy or some other energy, they can go and test that technology in the Faroe Islands because it's really small scale, but it's a big, it's one society, so you can test all the different consequences of introducing a new technology in a society. You have all the small cities, you have the small towns, you have the big city, you have everyone driving from one end of the country to the other, you have everything that goes on in a society, but very small scale. So it's an excellent test site. We also found out that direct and open dialogue is better than discussions through the media. And what do I mean by this? Well, it you know, people started talking and started realizing that, oh, is that what you're doing? Is that what you really mean? Or is, okay, because I read in the news that something else, something very different, and something very conflictual. And we have to remember that the job of journalists are to present oftentimes a conflict. And so that can really create a barrier to dialogue, for dialogue between an NGO or a company or authorities. So we have to remember not always to take for granted everything that media writes and just start talking, not through media, but directly with each other. And then we also found out that we really need to get all the young people involved because that's really where the future lies. And you're here today, so that's great. Then we talked about a process of getting there. And this was brought to us by Nico Kosoy from McGill, who said, and I'm sorry that I can't present it with as much energy as Nico can, but he said that it really starts with a feeling that, you know, we have this sense of something is wrong, something could be different, and then, you know, we start acting on that feeling and we start realizing something. We create some knowledge, so we get to a stage of knowing, and then we get to another stage of yearning, of wanting it to be different, of wanting something that we can now put more words on. And once we get there, we can start formulate strategies, or we can start working on getting there, and hopefully empower people of getting there. So including everyone in these processes of getting there, and then doing. So these would be the stages of a transformation. And I'm sure Leslie will put more words into these stages as well, and but also some of the problems of transformation, because it is really a very difficult thing to fathom. So I traced the use of the concept green growth and tied it up with different actors in time and place. And I think what's interesting is that we see that the concept of green growth began in East Asia in 2005 already, and that back then it was really tied up with an experience in Asian countries of dealing with a climate and environmental crisis and a poverty crisis. It was also about bringing people out of poverty, securing sustainable development, and better living conditions for all the many, many people living in Asia. But realizing that it can't happen within the same approach that all the Western countries have used and that most of Asian countries are using today, it's just not viable. It will just create a lot more problems and in much bigger scale. But then came in 2009 and or 2008 came a financial crisis and more people started realizing maybe this green growth could be an approach. And then after the failure of COP15 in the UN negotiations in 2010, more actors got together and thought, okay, well, maybe the UN system is not the way to move forward. And then there was already a concept being developed called green growth that many actors started working with and setting up new networks. And so we see that it really takes off globally in 2010, and that it's a state-driven concept in many ways, but it's also engaging a lot of different actors. And you see that research and policy in businesses, other forum and networks are part of this, and development and finance. A lot of banks, development banks and commercial banks are part of some of these networks. But again, some actors are also missing. There are not a lot of cities involved, although we do have the big city organizations involved. ICLEI, for example, the C40 are involved. So we do have some of the major city organizations involved. And there was a big project in the OECD working on green cities or green growth in cities as well. So we do have some of the big players involved, meaning that knowledge will disseminate to many other cities. But NGOs are really not part of this these networks, at least not in the time period that I've studied, ending in 2013. A lot could have happened in 14 and 15, and I'm not really sure of that. I have another visual display showing some of the main actors behind this. And we see in the beginning, Korea really stands out as one of the actors taking green growth to a global level. And we have Denmark also part of some of these networks, also together with Korea. And I'm sure Lisbeth is going to say a lot more about what is it that Denmark has been doing together with which other partners, not just other countries. Let me just say that this alliance, the Green Growth Alliance that Denmark is part of, first with Korea and Mexico, but then later joined by China, Kenya, Qatar, and Ethiopia now, and maybe some other countries are part. Anyways, Lisbeth will explain that. That is really an unusual alliance of countries not usually working together from different parts of the world, some big, some very small. That is really an odd alliance. And I think we as researchers should ask ourselves, how do we explain an alliance with Denmark, Korea, Mexico, China, Kenya, Qatar, Ethiopia? How do we explain that? I don't think we have theories today that can explain that sort of alliance. Then we also have something interesting like the Astana Green Bridge Initiative, which is in Kazakhstan. And where one of the organizations, the OSCE, is involved in this. And the approach to green growth in this part of the world is really something that we not normally think about when we say green growth. It's also about security. It's about good neighborship. It's about bridging Europe and Asia. And so all of a sudden, we also have the dimensions of security in green growth agendas. And I have another, let's see. So these are all the actors in, and all the squares are the networks, and all the diamonds are some of the key actors in. But zooming in on that, is it big enough for you to see? So what we see is really that there are some of the usual suspects, Germany, Japan, Denmark, Netherlands, Switzerland. But we also have many companies in here. We have some countries that we don't usually think of. We have Qatar in there. These are the most connected actors, those actors that are really part of many networks or take a leading role in spreading and developing and thinking about green growth. We have a lot of Asian countries and Asian actors. So it's really an agenda that is getting anchored up in different regions of the world, Asia, Europe, Africa, to began in 2011 and has been strengthening. And I know that the 3GF is also involved in different African networks. I think the only region of the world that is not really taking part of in green growth is the US and Canada, North American region. Everyone else is part of this agenda and within their own experience and with their own context. So in some parts of the world, it's about security. In some parts, it's about poverty alleviation, development. In other parts, it's about energy efficiency and small business development. You know, so it's really a big and diverse agenda.